you pray? How long since you stay on your knees till the light shone through? How long has it been since your mind felt at ease? How long since your heart knew no burden? Can you call him your friend? How long has it been since you knew that he cared for you? How long has it been since you knelt by your bed and prayed to the Lord up in heaven? How long since you knew that he'd answer you and would keep you the long night through? How long has it been since you walked with the dawn and felt that the day's worth the living? Can you call him your friend? How long has it been since you knew that he cared for you? Can you call him your friend? How long has it been since you knew that he cared for you? Share those with you, so I'm not really sure how all this will fit together, but I'm assuming it's something that we need. I don't even know how this part's going to fit in. I asked Brother Mike to give me a list of some people. Maybe you will recognize them. Betty Datum. Robert Datum. Steve Mullins. Dan Miller. Connie Iyer, Leanne Connor, Ray Lyons, George Ferris, James Tincher, Shirley Tincher, Shirley Harris, Ron Harris, Terry Stover, Leila Stover, Nancy Gleason, Helen Tudor, Charlotte Messenger, Deborah Bailey, best girl, seventh grade. She was a Spanish girl. She died of cancer. We had a young man by the name of Willie Wagner, who's a bus kid. Downtown, he happened to touch a light pole that wasn't grounded, and he was electrocuted to death. These and other people, I'm sure there were others, bus kids, parents. It'd be a shame. Some of these people left this world as just this side of being tragic. It would be a shame to believe there was nothing after this life. That would be tragic. These, and I'm sure there have been other people, can't remember some. There was a man we first started, we were in this building I met. He used to live over behind a donut shop over there on West Broad Street. I don't think the donut shop's there anymore. Lived back in that neighborhood. When I met him, he was already dying of cancer. He used to pull up in his Cadillac and park out front and make me stand there and talk to him for hours. And we would talk, and his kids wanted everything he had. He was dying of cancer. And he would talk to me, and we'd pray together. He had cancer, lung cancer. He smoked like a crane. And he said, "Preacher," he opened his shirt and showed me burn marks on his chest. From radiation. And he said, "I believe this is what's killing me." He'd already gone through everything he could, and by the way, he ended up dying of cancer. Those and many others, from children and fires. Somebody just innocently touched a light bulb, was electrocuted to death. Some found in a hallway. Some, many of us, watched a very dear man pass away. This will not be the end. It's appointed unto man wants to die. He just got through with Grandma, correct? In South Carolina. Grandmas don't die, they like going forever, right? I mean, they're always there. No, not true. These, some of these people, we have two or three on the hand called Betty. We used to call them the Bettys. Betty Rivers, Betty Datum, these people, Betty Yates, most of you don't even remember her, but they all came here together from the storefront because they were going to a dead Baptist church that used to be fundamental, and then they came here. They thought churches like that even almost 30-some years ago didn't exist anymore. They came here and they said, "Preacher, we can't believe it. We really thought churches like this didn't exist anymore." It'd break their heart if they saw what was going on today in new Baptist churches. I'm not sure why I brought this up right now. I just thought I should. I was doing some devotions for the staff and teachers. Listen, Kennedy. Kennedy. Okay. Okay, cool, cool. I want you to turn to Psalm 86. While you're doing that, can I make a statement? Real trouble produces real prayer. Now just think about that. Don't just amen. I understand why you did that, but just think about what exactly does that mean? What I just said basically was, real trouble helps us if we pray at all to make real prayers. In this Psalm 86, I was thinking about our church this week along with these things. I want you to notice here that some reasons or arguments David is giving as he comes before the Lord to pray. He's going to ask the Lord for something, but before he does, he's going to present why the Lord should listen to him, why he should. seven statements of why God should hear and answer his prayer. I want you to understand that seven is God's number. It's a number of perfection. It's a number of completion. It is the number of maturity. So this is no accident why this is going on right here. You understand that? So I want to start, if I could please, with verse number one. Let's read all seven verses, then I'll go back and make some statements. Bow down thine ear, verse number one, Psalm 86. Bow down thine ear, O Lord, and hear me, for I am poor and needy. Preserve my soul, for I am holy. And thou, my God, save thy servant that trusteth in thee. Verse 3. Be merciful unto me, O Lord, for I cry unto thee daily. Rejoice the soul of thy servant, for unto thee, O Lord, do I lift up my soul. Verse 5. For thou, Lord, art good, ready to forgive, plenteous in mercy unto all them that call upon thee. Verse 6. Give ear, O Lord, unto my prayer, and attend to the voice of my supplication. In the day of my trouble, I will call upon thee, for thou wilt answer me. And there his coming to the Lord, and what drove him to the Lord was trouble. Isn't it odd how we hate trouble? How we wish God would take it all away? There are a lot of good things that come out of hardships and trouble, whether we like it or not. That's why the Bible said, all things work together for good. It didn't say for you. All things work together for good to those who love the Lord, to them who are called according to his mercy. He's simply saying, quit looking at things like, okay, hardship. David's talking about, I'm
did real well. We worked three, ran two. We had a great time on buses this morning. Visitors, people coming in. Okay, so I had to cast out two and cut off a couple of hands. We're okay. It's part of the gig, that's just the way it goes. But the part that I enjoy the most, with all of that going on, I kept thinking, what is the problem here? Good indicator, good indicator, good indicator, good indicator across the board. Why can we not? Well, God out of something tough had to teach us himself. Or we had to start trusting him again. You remember back when I preached on faith? Probably not, but I preached on faith. Great message. I love it. And I told you, faith has evidence and substance. Oh, wait a minute. If I knew the evidence and the substance before I got started, I don't have to trust. I already know how it's going to turn out. So faith is this. God said that, and I need it. Okay. So far, I just read it as belief. When I start walking, because that's what he said, as I prove what is that good and perfect and acceptable will of God, I have to move forward by faith. Then I get out here and I go, I can see it now. I can see it now. I couldn't see it here. I had to trust here only because God said it. So I walk forward with God, and as God begins to fulfill those things, I look back and go, it happened. Amen. This is, preacher, you won't believe what just took place. Yes, I will. I'll believe it. Sure, I will. Because that's the way faith is. That's the way faith works. But see, we listen to charismatics. Faith is a belief in God. I have to do whatever I ask him to do. If I say I'm done, that's not true. Absolutely not true. That's just pretty blasphemous. I want you to look at Psalm 130. I can't ask of the Lord. scripture than even you hear in a whole week. But please understand, people need you cannot have a spirit-filled service without unity. You cannot have a body of believers without unity. You cannot accomplish anything without unity. You cannot be pleasing to God as a church without unity. If there is one thing that I think is overwhelmingly prevalent in our church right now, it's that word right there. Do you understand the other day what Jordan and I presented to you? If our church was in turmoil, if our church was in strife, if our church was at each other's throat, and then that came up, could you imagine? So you know what God did? Back here, God began to teach us, mold us, prepare us. See, God knew what was coming. And as we kept walking forward, John describes, it's like